So, from your left, Alexi Worth, who is a painter, and he's one of those people who says he's given up writing. In fact, it sort of reminds us of Mark Twain. It's very easy to give up writing. He's done it often. He was once the critic on the one of the unsigned critics on the New Yorker and a prolific critic on Art Forum and other places, but he now just writes the occasional catalogue essay. Anything good in the works in that department?
Well, I wrote an essay about Carol Dunham, which will be in the appear for his upcoming Blum and Poe show in Los Angeles.
Fantastic, great, and. I'm imagine you're spending a bit of time in your studio as well, although you've had quite a lot of outings recently. You had a show at DC Moore not so long ago, right? So something else in the pipeline, I'm sure. Sarah Douglas, who's already been identified in one of her jobs, a biologically determined one, is also editor of Art News. The successor of Thomas B. Hess and other illustrious people along the way. Anything exciting happening in that journal, which has recently kind of merged with Art in America? What's that about?
We have the same owner now.
Oh, the same owner.
In
right.
Peter Brandt. We have our issues have themes, so our underrated issue is out right now, which I highly recommend, and we're just closing up our summer issue, so there are exciting things in there. I won't reveal it.
Fantastic. Well, we'll run out and buy it instead, or look at it for free online. Okay, thank you very much. And Ara H. Merjian? First question, am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Fine.
It'll do. Okay.
It'll do.
But this is Brooklyn. We take multiculturalism very seriously. So what would you say your name is?
I always say Ara, if you Ara. Can roll the R, yeah. Yeah.
Ara.
But then sometimes people try to over-roll it and it becomes Ara. So Ara is fine.
Right.
Alexi always gets it right, for which I very much.
Well, I think Alexi has the distinction of actually having been your teacher once. Is that not the case?
He was my painting teacher, tragically for him, in college.
Right.
Yes, he was.
Perhaps having a painter writer as an instructor.
Well,
was what
he
led
was.
You
I must say, he was a fantastic teacher, and it was an amazing, amazing class. Right. I was certainly one of the less gifted painters, which is, of course, why I became an art historian. Right? It's textbook psychoanalysis.
Yes, those who do, and those who can't write art history. Okay, you are, however, a professor in the Italian Studies department.
That's right.
At NYU.
That's right.
I know that you've written a book on De Chirico and Nietzsche, a very topical subject with that marvelous exhibition at the Center of Italian Modern Art in Soho. What's the next title going to be?
The next book, which I'm just finishing up, is called Against the Avant-Garde, and it's on Pierpaolo Pasolini and the art world in the 60s in Italy.
Fantastic. Great. Well, good luck with that. Look forward to it.
And thank you.
Why the hell are you laughing? I mean, I know I have comic genius, but I'm wishing him good luck and I'm looking forward to it. I mean, why is that funny? I hope you're laughing at me, not him. You can do all you like laughing at me, but I do take my the sensitivities of my guests very seriously. Anyway, guests, we have the great privilege of being able to swivel around on these chairs, and we're now ready to watch the first video.
We start our discussion this evening with two exhibitions in Chelsea, Anoka Foaruqee at Koenig & Clinton and Vija Celmins at Matthew Marks. Foaruqee's exhibition, her second with this gallery, titled Bruises and Rainbows, continues to focus on intersections between perception and paint process. Foaruqee applies paint with customized steel cones that generate a variety of circular motions and moiré effects. Working on linen applied to panels, she sands her surfaces to achieve a generally matte, even effect. She's fond of glitches that, according to Martha Schwendener in the New York Times, are preserved like fossils. The final effect is disruptive and uncanny, Schwendener writes. As Foaruqee told David Humphrey in an exchange recorded at Yale in 2013, there are a lot of things happening with colour in the moiré patterns that are kind of illusionistic. yet I don't want the materiality to be lost. I feel like I'm sublimating the materiality for the optical experience, and so much of what you are seeing are traces or residues of material events. Vija Celmins, who's been the subject of museum shows around the world, is having her first exhibition with Matthew Marks. Reviewing it in the New York Times, Holland Cotter writes, "No natural elements are deeper and darker than the ones Vija Celmins paints. Ocean and sky, specifically the rippling surface of the Pacific of California, and the night sky seen through telescopes as a dense, soft, pointillist field of thousands of individual stars. She magnifies the vastness of both by leaving out any framing orienting references, a horizon line, say, to the element we're most comfortable with, Earth. Imagery, however, is not her foremost concern. As the artist says, the recognizable image is just one element to consider. The paintings seem more a record of my grappling with how to transform that image into a painting and make it alive. A painting in six parts, which is dated 1986-7 and 2012-16. A group of six oil paintings based on a photograph she took 50 years ago from a pier in Venice, California, provides her with an armature on which I hang my marks and make my art. The scrutiny of Salmon's gaze is perhaps most evident in her new sculptures, according to the gallery press release. Two stones and four stones consist of small rocks accompanied by painted bronze replicas, virtually indistinguishable from the original. Similarly, her blackboard tableau works from 2007-15 collect 19th or early 20th century writing slates and then use wood, paint, and pastel to create identical twins."
So, Anoka Foaruqee, taking paint for a spin. What this is the second show we've seen of her work. I find them rather exhilarating. They give us a lot to look at and something to think about. But it's interesting to me that the teacher, the painter, Foaruqee, is a instructor at Yale and is somebody often included in group exhibitions at prestigious venues. I'm surprised. I'm pleasantly surprised to see these paintings, because they don't seem very of the moment. Am I missing something? What do they seem like? They seem like a little bit of a throwback. Sarah, would you say that they are very of our moment, or are they a little aloof from the times?
I don't know if I would say that. She's definitely drawing on op art, that tradition. I would say, my reaction to these paintings, first of all, I'd be very interested to hear painters talk about these paintings, because it seems to me there is so much going on with color in them that she is clearly they're clearly quite accomplished. I liked them more than I wanted to. I'm not sure I can explain that kind of statement. On the other hand,
more than you suspected you might.
You know, what's interesting about these paintings is they also register so much differently as reproductions than they do in person.
Right.
So I think one thing that has to be pointed out about them, and something that maybe endeared them to me, or me to them, I can't remember how that's constructed, is that when, so they have this effect when you're standing back of these moiré patterns, of this oppy effect. Then, of course, when you get up close and you look at the side of the painting, there's all kinds of drippy paint sort of coming off the side, as though it's oozing out of this incredibly formal situation. And that made me like them more. It's a bit all over the place, but maybe someone can take it from there.
bit like a sort of a muffin sort of spilling out over the edges, that it feels more homemade and less industrial if you got that.
That's one way of putting it. Mm. You felt the paint in a different way, I think.
Doesn't it also, Ara, the gunky kind of accumulations of the edges makes it sort of serve as an index to the painting, because the paintings often have two or three kind of colors, two colors producing a moiré third effect, but seeing more colors as a kind of index, an index of the effort that got to that slick finish.
Well, I would think of the index in terms of the patterns that have shaped the surface of the painting, right? That in this instance, it's clearly not a brush that's been used. And so she's not only kind of allying herself with op art, but also with the sort of this disavowal of the hand, right? With the artist kind of, starting in the 60s and 70s, the neo-avant-garde sort of renouncing the hand and the individuality of the artist to kind of sort of mimic the kind of technocratic and technological production that had kind of taken over as a liberation from sort of bourgeois individuality, right? I mean, she's clearly going back to that moment. But also, I thought, you know, there's something slightly nostalgic about them in the sense of that kind of psychedelic, you know, I thought of, you know, the sort of dorm posters from high school and college, these velvet psychedelic posters that people would like to look at when they're smoking pot, basically. I mean, they're clearly sort of playing on that sort of nostalgia to a certain extent, but I like the surface events that she enlivens them with over and above the more regulated indexical tracings of that she's used to comb over the paint. That there are, she clearly still is invested to some extent with accident, with the splatter of paint, and I too like the spill over the impasto that the sort of spills over the side, gives it this kind of materiality that, you know, it's fun to see. I certainly was not blown away by them to any extent. I thought that they were interesting, but not mind-blowing.
Right, right. Alexi, I guess that they do fit into a current of painting that... painting that goes beyond the brush and that goes back to a process preoccupation with misregistrations, technical effects, technical glitches. Is she kind of a more palatable Wade Guyton or something like that, for instance?
Palatable. Sure, I think that's a good comparison. I found myself, for one thing, you're talking about the brushes, the catalog, the monograph, has these big pictures of her studio full of brushes. And I was like, and there's like, you know, it's like a million different small kind of sable brushes and filberts.
Maybe
and
on Sunday she does impressionist landscapes.
But I said to them, why are these here? Like, how come she has so many brushes? And they didn't know. And it's a little mysterious. But... you know, in thinking about an art world that's so retrospective, where we have such a rich set of past options to be thinking about, her work seems so judicious and artful in its retrospectiveness, in the ways that it touches back to so many different prior moments without over-investing in any one. Mm. And you can create a little kind of multiple provenances and say, yes, she's, I kept thinking of a kind of super dry, cerebral Karen Davey, who is herself a kind of artfully retro return to op in different ways. I think the reason that people keep talking about how smart she is that she negotiates that kind of sense of multiple memories so well and doesn't ever seem like she's, you know, allowing you to say, oh, you come from X only. It's always, there's kind of some David Reed elements, there's there's a combination of all these different things, and you find yourself in a little kind of contemporary art historical conversation with her where the paintings are always giving back kind of thoughtful, evasive answers. I guess I was a little bit more excited than Ara sounded, because above all about the color and the weird way that these square paintings felt so so vivid, so present, like the bullet-like ones seemed to be like bulging out and then dropping way back. Mm-hmm. For, you know, for a show of all square paintings, it seemed remarkably like optically voluptuous. My problem was, the only area where I felt more hesitant was, and here I'm the opposite of Ada's take, the muffin top corners and the glitches. I took them to be a kind of register of her desire for, and she talks about this in the interview that's in that catalog, a desire for fucked upness and imperfection and a kind of
over materiality to
and
to
materiality
offset the opticality
and the human, right, and something
all those
human.
Things, and it seems like that seems right. The paintings are so, there's a kind of snow-blind dazzling beauty to them that seems dangerously over perfect, and she's pushing against it, but right now the way she does feels a little bit like it feels, I'm not sure that it's entirely authentic to the method. It feels a little bit like it's a careful, cautious hedge against what could be kind of oppressive in the paintings. And I almost think they might be braver if they were more oppressive.
If she embraced the cerebral quality of them.
It's a like a super
finish.
Eloquent person, you know, adding some like swear words or a belch, you know, to the end of their peroration,
which sometimes works.
I'm uncertain about it. It's not that it doesn't work, but that's where my question, my sense, I'm not sure I trust her on that.
They don't seem like accents or add-ons to me. They are clearly generated by the process, and so if she went further and removed them, she would have a different image. So,
but it does beg the question of to what extent they're casual and to what extent they've been added. I mean, certainly in some areas where there's actually straight paint, it's clearly not been just simply an accident of process. She's gone on and actually.
Oh dear, it's perfect. I'll do it another two revolutions and get a glitch.
There are moments like that where it seems that those imperfections have been at least courted, if not sought actively.
Courted is a good word. That's how I feel about it. I mean, one doesn't know. But courted, yes. Sounds. That might be true.
Courted more than tolerated.
I mean, the other thing is that in reproduction, the reproduction dulls, of course, the vibration, right? The kind of almost phenomenological encounter that you have with them where your eyes kind of go nuts.
I think especially those three primary colored ones, the whitest of the paintings in the room and the biggest, I found those really increasing. On my second visit, I liked them more than the first, and I found myself really feeling that they were, you know, they couldn't have been simpler in some ways, and yet they were, I don't know, kind of a pretty remarkable experience to stand in front of.
Yeah, yeah. So, but let's spend a moment longer on this, the intentional contingency. That's what we're talking about, I think, really, because she actually has both an aesthetic, an underlying aesthetic and a process that one feels can and should produce a very slick, optical effect. It is optical effect driven. Mm-hmm. So this insistence on the handmadeness, and perhaps that's what those brushes are doing in the photograph in the catalog. It's to say, I'm still a hands-on painter despite these custom designed metal combs. She sort of presents herself as a bit of a dualist, but it could be viewed as a bit of an anxiety, not to be categorized as the slick perfectionist.
But I think it's a very right. It's an anxiety that I'm so totally sympathetic to. It seems to me another proof that we're dealing with a very sophisticated mind.
Yes,
with the work, and that I feel kind of invested in the future of this work and excited about where it is, but more the first.
Right. Okay, let's Let's turn to our second exhibition of the evening. We're still in Chelsea. We're going to see Vija Celmins, who's having her first show with Matthew Marks after showing for quite a number of years with the McKee Gallery, which shut its doors recently. And its various stars have moved on to other galleries. And Matthew Marks has scooped up Vija Celmins. You love her or you hate her. Ara, the departure perhaps for this show for her is sculpture and 3D work. But we're still also with the iconic Celmins night sky motif. One painting, one work in six panels is dated over several decades of night sky.
It's a bit like your shirt, actually.
No kidding, really?
From a distance.
From a distance. I actually did buy this shirt 2 days after going to a benefit gig honoring Vija Celmins. And the first time I wore it, my friend said, why couldn't you have got that 2 days earlier and really worn it at the Vija Celmins event? But anyway, my shirt notwithstanding. Ara, let's launch with you this time.
Sure, sure. I suppose my take boils down to this. Certainly her first show at Matthew Marks, and she's put some new work on it in it. And let me start by saying that I admire her work immensely. I think that her work has generated a lot of important sort of discussion, and certainly kept figuration alive at times where I think it had undergone some various sort of challenges to its relevance. There was absolutely nothing remotely new in the show. I mean, almost every single thing in the show were either repeats of things that she's done in the past or actual things from far earlier. It was virtually identical to a show that I remember seeing at the Reina Sofia in Madrid in around 1997. So I suppose I was at once suspended between my admiration for the craft of her work and the diligence that she applies to it, and the almost, Giorgio Morandi-like, almost seemingly autistic focus, and the fact that that she's really not done anything remotely new that she's wanted to include.
I guess if you paint the night sky, you think in longer time spans than the average art career, and perhaps.
Well, again, I mean, the Morandi perhaps is the duration is obviously one of much more sort of nuanced change, and it takes nothing away from her, I suppose, the quality of her achievement, but I do still think it keeps alive questions about authenticity and reproduction, even in the age of 3D printing. So, for example, the tablets that she reproduces, the blackboards that she sort of salvaged and painstakingly reproduced in all of their detail, every stray mark on the original tablet is recreated to such unbelievable meticulous detail, and it's almost impossible to verbalize the stunning, mesmerizing, even disturbing identicalness of these objects. And it really conjures up the idea of course, part of it is the game, which is the original and which is the copy. And that, of course, opens on to larger questions about what authenticity is, what is it rooted in, particularly in an age when now entire objects can be printed identically. But I don't know how you guys felt, but I was surprised that in this first exhibition at Matthew Marks that she presented no sort of new work.
Well, it may, of course, be that she knows of some innovation, but it'll take the art world equivalent of light years for it to transmit to us. Sarah, are you a fan of Vija Celmins?
Well, I mean, it's funny you should use that word, because I think that's exactly, in preparing for this, I read, reread Randy Kennedy's piece about, a little profile of her, and he used that word. He's, and I think that's exactly right. Either you're a fan of hers or you're not, in a way. I have a this is extraneous to the conversation, but I have a kind of nostalgic attachment to her work because it was actually one of the first exhibitions I saw when I moved to New York in 1992 at the Whitney, and I remember that show so vividly. But it's interesting, in seeing this show, I had a similar reaction to yours, remembering the show at the Whitney and thinking, oh, well, you know, nothing's much changed. But I'm not sure that's the point of what she does. And and perhaps if we, I mean, of course, she has painted in a different mode. I'm thinking of the painting of a heater at the Whitney that the Whitney owns.
Yes,
very early one.
Which is a great painting. at the same time, when I saw the exhibition, I was thinking about two other exhibitions that happen to be up right now. That's okay if we bring up other shows.
Yes.
Okay. Which is, you know, so if you've been to Chelsea recently, so just a nearby is a show at Vic Muniz. An artist who I think can be kind of gimmicky. So it's like, which is the real rope and which is the photograph of a rope? Next painting. Which is the real crayon? And I'm making that up, but you get the point.
Yeah, it's a Spotwaldo kind of,
Over and over and over, varied and sort of spiced up and presented in a different way. And then on the other hand, you have Uptown at Aquavella, an exhibition of Damien Loeb, a painter I don't especially like. But they were also paintings of the night sky, and he did them from photographs. He took, you know, from photographs, very meticulously painted. but then, you know, so on the one hand, you think about the experience of the Moonieses, and then you look at, you know, the rocks that she made that are, and the blackboard that you were describing. And I really, you know, for me, the act of looking at those and taking them in is a kind of analog to her process, meditative process in creating these things. And I think that they induce that in a way that, you know, is thrown into high relief when you compare it to something like the Vic Muniz's, right?
Yes. Well, those two young men are sort of... I know that Loeb is painstaking by his own standards, but they're both kind of neither is really the kind of saintly hermit that one gets the impression that Celmins is. I mean, Celmins is kind of a Zen conceptualism,
of course,
isn't it?
Of
it's
course,
it's a project, you know, a bit like On Kawara, but it's actually a photorealist as well. It's like.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and I find that, you know, I guess if you're a fan of hers, you can't see enough of those night skies. You can't see enough of those wave paintings.
I wonder, though, even if you're a fan, and I must sort of confess I'm not. I mean, I'm a moderate admirer and don't dislike them enough to want to say anything mean about them. But I wonder what a fan would do with... two or with three rather than two, or two rather than one. I don't quite know how to look at them, to be honest. Perhaps Alexi, you could enlighten me.
You've described my position. I am a deep anti-fan. I really hate that work. I hate it. I'm so glad you mentioned Damien Loeb, because the idea of some of his star paintings and some of hers together would be a kind of fantastic anti-show for me, the worst, just the worst things together at last. I want to see them, but I care more about what I dislike in her work because she's brilliant. Because there are moments, and that heater painting is a painting that every art student finds and loves, where you see how intelligent and talented she is. And there was one piece in this show where I felt I could see that again, and it made me furious at the others. I feel like...
And which was that piece?
It's a drawing on the back wall. I think it's one of the reverse skies. It's in graphite on acrylic on paper. It was really kind of startling to me because I the first time I saw the show, I had my normal Vija Celmins reaction, which is a kind of glum, you know, just a deep negative feeling to see, to me, a brilliant painter... continuing on a sterile path. And
brilliant because she has a control and a measure, or because there must be more to being a brilliant painter than just nerdishness.
Yes, there is, and but I mean, as I say, I think I've seen it in prior paintings, especially the very early work.
Right.
And you know, the tonal delicacy of those paintings. There's a bunch of formal things that are there, especially if you spend a little bit of time comparing the six versions of that oceanscape. You can see she's doing all kinds of delicate little things that are not trivial, but they end up feeling trivial to me. And the substitution of dedication for imagination, I can't ever support.
Well, that's why I brought up Morandi, right? Because again, the subtle sort of gradations between studio light, between 6 p.m. and 7 p.m., or between two bottles, or instead of three, there's a kind of nuance. The duration is right, and these are sort of
But there's nothing procedural or conceptual in Morandi. I mean, each one
would disagree. I would disagree.
Each one is. It's like looking at somebody who paints nudes. I mean,
I think that's why he's, you know, Morandi's been a huge sort of touchstone for a lot of conceptual artists. And that's why he's so, I think, overrated, is that he's claimed by painters and by the sort of more cerebral.
Claimed by two constituencies, you're saying. Yeah.
He's sort of lionized by both crowds. And I think that's why when you look at that panel, that wall of Celmins' waves, I immediately thought of the kind of those minute gradations, as Alexi put it, in those, you know, in those endless still lives, which is a similarly, for me, kind of ultimately sterile path.
No. That's fun. We got a serious argument here.
No, because Morandi is voluptuous, sensual, and each one is a unique moment of that jar or tin in the studio on this day. They're so phenomenological and perceptual,
but phenomenological and voluptuous are not the same thing. There's nothing sensual about a Morandi to me at all. They're the most sort of cerebral.
I don't know what gesture I could pop. I need an emoji. Help. But can I just quickly just throw
maybe the etchings would subscribe to that, but I'm not sure there, really, to be honest. No, I think we're in different zones here, but yeah.
Earth tones and sort of brushwork do not sensuality make. I'm sorry. That's my...
No. I adore this because there's so much piety about Morandi that I enjoy Ada's heterodox take enormously, although I cannot come over to your evil team here. But I wanted to say this one drawing, which I recommend. I'm curious to know if other people have the same or similar take on it. It's on the back wall. I believe it's called Reverse Night Sky Number 6. I didn't bring my notes, but it's a relatively small piece on the left-hand side of the back wall. And here's what's different about
it. Yes, okay.
It's to me, the sequence of little marks have a kind of almost like a violence to them. They're these skittering little connect the dots, close sequences that make little arcs and curves that are, to me, shockingly different, above all from the paintings, where there's a kind of bland distribution that I can't begin to pay attention to. I looked at this accidentally and I was stunned. I thought, oh, that's an interesting area. And then I began moving around. I thought the whole drawing, and I wonder, it's in graphite, so maybe it has something to do with the material, but I felt I saw again the liveliness that I saw in some of the very early works in that one piece.
I think her intention is to suppress any liveliness. They're like, it's like you went to hear Morton Feldman and he'd had too much to drink that day and he was sounding like some jazz player. And so you say, oh, that's something that's not the real Feldman, so this is not the real Celmins.
I don't see it as a suppression of liveliness. I see it as attention to a different register of things. I think that it's interesting, you know, you keep using the word sterile. I really think it's interesting, you know, to think about that word. Well, they both used it.
Yes.
And because to me that you consider the word sterile, you immediately think of these objects that she so painstakingly recreated
are not stones.
Not just the objects themselves, but I'm thinking of the blackboard, all the little marks on it. In a way, but then she puts it in this airless vitrine. So it's kind of taking this well-worn, you know, object and putting it in a sterile environment. And I happen to also like that kind of situation, that push and pull between those two things.
I'm a serious skeptic, but I don't think, I think the comparison with Vic Muniz is very interesting, because I don't think she has a programmatic kind of Joseph Kosuth, here are three chairs, dictionary definition, chair, blah, blah. I don't think there's anything of that in what she's, I don't think she's didactic. I think she sets herself these Sisyphean tasks for her own redemption, not for our edification. Whereas Muniz, I think, is sort of Professor Muniz telling us, oh, look, this is a real button, and this is a photograph of a button, or whatever. You know, that's a different quality of experience.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe we can just talk just briefly about the question of craft, right? Because, you know, because craft is so sort of verboten in high modernist and certainly scholarly, most scholarly critical discourses, right? She does, you know, in a way that made me, and sometimes think even of Sherry Levine, obviously in a perhaps a less conceptual way, but the question of authenticity and imitation and the skill, the craft that it takes for her to make those objects, right? I'm not talking about the paintings, I'm talking about the blackboards and the stones. I mean, what Alexi, you sort of recoil even from that project. Is that, do you find nothing redemptive?
What about Robert Gober with the replication?
Or Gober, yeah, absolutely.
You use the word diligence, and it's kind of a superhuman diligence, but what could be worse than that?
But doesn't it raises questions, though. I mean, I don't think she's doing it in the way that David points out about Muniz and this kind of spectacle. I don't think it's a spectacle. I think it really is a kind of meditative question of what does it mean to make an object that can be perceived identically to another.
But and we, that, that we have a human... whole sequence of paired object experiences going back to Factum 1 and Factum 2.
Yes,
the
absolutely.
Brillo boxes,
absolutely.
Other examples. This has been done better before.
But it's very different than Rauschenberg's Factum 1, Factum 2, because that still involves chance, it still involves, right, there are subtle differences between them that let you know that, in fact, the seemingly, unimitable, abstract expressionist sort of genius mark is, in fact, copyable. This is so much more kind of psychotic in its identicalness that it takes it to a different plane of...
Listen, to me, it takes it to a plane of sentimentality and nostalgia, a meditative, quiet, but deeply sentimental thing of like, oh, the cherished 19th century artifact, oh, the schoolroom, oh, education, handwriting, cursive.
I don't think thematics.
I don't think the thematics
enter into it at all.
I don't think the subjects matter at all. Yeah. Other than as vehicles
of difficulty. All of them. I think each of them is a poetic, tender, delicate, sentimental choice.
No, I don't think so. I think they're ocean, I think they surface, transcend. They're the meant night to transcend sky. their actual content. I think.
I mean, they are fairly sort of. I mean, they're not mass-produced objects, and they're not, but that's, they're stones are organic. The blackboards are using natural materials, but in a factory situation. But yeah, they're not Brillo boxes. They're not. It almost seems that these are just made for her, and we are witnessing the zen of her having made them, and that gives some people a thrill and some connection to something. It sends me to sleep, but each to their own in a sort of way. They look like they have the nerdishness of Chuck Close before he moved into the loopy circles. Yes, that
well, they're co-generational.
Yes,
right?
they're photorealists. I mean, the fact that she's working from photos. Yeah.
The early Chuck Close,
to me, they, it's a cruel thing to say, but aesthetically, I mean, Chuck's health problems helped him. I mean, were saved the day because it produced interesting marks at last.
Well,
but we wouldn't want
to. You know that those preceded.
We're not going to get into that, but it would have been just as interesting but different painter.
Yes.
That hadn't happened.
All right. Good time for the audience to come in then on Anoka Foaruqee or via Celmins. And there'll be a mic working its way around. Let's perhaps start with Celmins, as she's the freshest in mind. And anybody in the audience care to weigh in on this? The issues raised. I mean, are these subjects are the subjects significant and sentimental, or are they expedient vehicles? Are we supposed to really savor her craft, or is it? Is it just her business, how she goes about her job? Are these didactic in some way or hermetic? Yes, there's some in the front row, please. Wait for the mic, if you wouldn't mind.
I think that what you've been saying sort of hits on the problem with them is that in that there's no room for you as a viewer in the experience. And to me, that's like a big problem, because to like them or to, you know, love them is to admire them and not to be particularly challenged by them. And if it was about just for her, which I think could be interesting, then why the example of the original? You know, like, I think that the inclusion with the rocks and the chalkboards of the original there, it's sort of like, ooh, look at how wonderfully she managed to, you know, like capture all the nuances of, you know, an essentially random situation. But she always has a static thing in front of her. I mean, when you were talking about Mirandi, I mean, Mirandi is essentially dealing with something that, even though it might be static and sitting there, he's, you know, limited by his observation, whereas the photograph, it's like there. I mean, she can always get it better or, you know, like more exact or something like that. But in the end, the bigger problem is, where are you in the process of interacting with them, in like making them alive in a way? It seems like your options are very limited. It doesn't give the viewer very much freedom. That's all.
Right. Thank you.
It seemed to me that it's really a philosophical question. It's at first I had the same feeling that, oh, okay, so you're making something exactly like something else. But it was the water paintings of the photograph that actually brought me in. And it made me realize that the question is, when you look at something, you're never seeing it the same, no matter what it is. It's always going to look different to you every day. And what's really real in life and what isn't, and how it's always changing every second in everything that we see. And then the water of this photograph that she was obsessed with redoing over and over and over, because every time that she looked at it, it looked different. And the subtleties of every time how it changes is really the magic of it all. I mean, it's a very simple concept. It's, you know, it's not a very complicated thing. That's it.
Thank you. No, that's...
I actually think that what she was saying touches on something that I like about this work. And, you know, again, maybe this is slightly extraneous, but I think at a time when we all spend a lot of our time in the mode of, I do this and then I'm done with it. And then I do this and then I'm done and I move on to the next thing, that it's refreshing to have this, to if you can enter into it, to enter into this kind of singularity of purpose and vision that seems so antithetical to the way a lot of life operates right now.
Do we have any responses to our discussion on Anoka Foaruqee, on the materiality versus the opticality of those paintings, whether those glitches are tolerated or courted?
It's funny, when we were talking about that, I feel almost as that those are as difficult to talk about for me as, you know, it's like something like Wade Guyton. It's like, how do you get into that? You know, I felt a similar thing. Like, it's the same that you talk about the glitches in his work. There's some kind of similar thing going on there.
For sure.
For sure, or maybe, because I think with him, the glitches are it. I mean, they have to be the glitches. They're mortgaged to their own glitches. Whereas with her, I feel that it's that she's a more she's a hands-on, genuine painter, and that these are there's a whole different relationship to the generation of quirks in her work.
And I don't want to get stuck on it, but just before we left talking about her, you know, glanced back and looked at one of them, and you know, Alexi, you were talking about their squares, and in fact, you know, you look at them and they're, well, they're squares, but they're not, they're kind of fuzzy squares. And I, you know, I mean, I know you had some arguments with that, but I think that makes them more knowable, more organic, more approachable, maybe even in a way that doesn't register on a conscious level when you're engaging with them.
I didn't have any problem with them being squares. In fact, in a way, it was the fact that they were so, that they were all squares, that to me, it's surprising to me that a whole room full of square paintings could do what they did.
No, I just mean that their edges are...
Oh, I see.
You know, often we
clean.
Think of a square as a clean square, and these weren't. They were kind of a little bit wobbly.
Right. Mm-hmm.
They had, you know, uneven edges. I like that part of it.
I guess I found it too likable.
God forbid.
But it's a little bit like the painterliness of the 50s, of Alfred Leslie or something like that, the splash that became a kind of over-seductive ornamental mark that I think in the last 20 years we've seen a kind of painterly materiality sometimes does the same thing.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. Jess, cool. Thank you.
pardon me. I'll admit I wasn't particularly impressed by the Foaruqee show. I couldn't help but see it in sort of through the lens of a kind of zombie formalism, that it's sort of tied to this this very particular process and this very particular sense of its own materiality. I mean, as far as that goes, it's very good zombie formalism. I think that it's right. She's not numbing her hands of Novocaine. She's not making a fire extinguisher. She's using this process, which isn't completely obvious. I mean, it could have been done with a brush. It could have been done with a brush if she had, you know, an infinite amount of time and an infinite number of assistants. But I don't know. I think in the end, I just didn't really move beyond that process to anything deeper. I mean, I'm sure, you know, you guys had insights into it, which I obviously didn't get. But that was my take on it anyway.
All right. Perhaps Vija Celmins needs to make a meticulous copy of Anoka Foaruqee, and that will keep her busy for a long time. And then we can exhibit them together. Excellent.
Damien Loeb.
Just as a quick response, I think those doubts are totally legitimate. I felt like I came to it with feeling some of the same things and was won over more than I expected to be, among other things, by the color, by like those colors are so worked, so like particular, and if they feel to me like they're particular to what's going to happen to them, to the interference, etc. And the simplicity of some of the ways that they are made too, that like at the center of every one, there's a little moment where the two different circles, the inner circles are over kind of linked and overlap, and you can see the whole construction of the picture begins there. That somehow that felt generous, kind of open. Here's how it happens. Here's how it works. Mm-hmm. That pulled it away
transparent.
From
transparent. Yeah.
Yeah. From the sort of like strategic cynicism of zombie formalism.
Mm. Yeah. That's the homemade zombie formalism as a sensual zombie formalism. We can be here for a while with variants on that. It's a lot. Yes, the last comment. Would you? Yeah, please wait for the mic, though. The front row, please, if you would.
Well, Alexi, you just made me think of a question. What do you think she should do with the sides of the painting? Because I think the goop is, I mean, that is really like the goop that comes out after combing it. Mm. So what should she do? Should she like sand it off or
scrape it off or try to use less paint or, I mean, that, I mean, I think your comment's so interesting, but I don't know what the solution is.
I don't have the solution to it, but I miss, it's just a question in my mind. I feel like it looks a little theatrical. It looks a little, it's back to Ada's word, which was what, hunted for, or I can't,
like courted. Courted.
Courted, kind of, yes. Yeah. I don't know. You know, honestly, I don't know. But Wade Guyton makes it less of a question because you feel, yes, it's out of his hands. Here, it's in her hands. It distracts me.
Actually, an interesting point of comparison would be to the painter Ian Davenport, who showed at Paul Kasmin earlier this season. And you with him, you get these drips of paint. And at the bottom, they all do, they all go back and forth. And that's showing how, you know, a strategy for making a painting can then lead to a strategy to end the painting, and it's just another motif within his sort of lexicon of strategies. And I think with her, it doesn't have that feeling quite. I mean, it is obviously part of a routine, but not a strategy. If then one can draw a distinction between the two. Cool. I think we're in good time now to, yes, perfect time to move on to part two. So let's do our swiveling, panelists, and enjoy the movie. And see you in a minute, everyone.
Part two of our discussion takes us to the Lower East Side for exhibitions of Jennifer Coates at Freight and Volume and Leonhard Hurzlmeiser at Rachel Ufner. The title of Coates' exhibition, All You Can Eat, is a Depression-era concept and harbinger of post-war industrialized food production and attendant ecological disaster. Yet convenience food also possesses a magic that harkens back to an earlier time, the artist writes. Ice cream cones and popsicles are like portable rock art from the Paleolithic era. Instead of carrying around a small figurine as a talisman, we put ours on a stick and eat it. In the burning of the marshmallowy s'mores is the beginning and end of civilization. The smear of cream cheese glows like an all-seeing eye through the portal of the everything bagel, welcoming you into the bacterial pointillism of swarming bits on its surface. Coates cites with approval Terence McKenna's observation that cows and early hominids wandered the savannas of Africa in tandem, and that since psychedelic mushrooms grow in cow patties, the origin of human consciousness was spurred by the ingestion of these treats in the cow poop. In his American debut, German artist Leonhard Hurzlmeiser presents an exhibition at Rachel Ufner titled All New Women. It follows on the heels of shows in Munich titled New Women and Latest Women, suggesting a pattern in his iconography. Dr. Daniela Stoppel of Ludwig Maximilians University Munich writes, "The fact that the paintings are evocative of synthetic cubist works, such as those by Leger and Herbin, or pictograms or emoticons, is less due to consciously sought-after references to the 1920s or contemporary forms of visual communication, but the result of a lengthy process of form-finding." The show has been favorably reviewed in the New York Times by Roberta Smith, who writes, "Flattened yet statuesque, these agile Amazons are frequently in motion, their poses simplified by strong colors. Bandy Mandy shows a large woman in purple with orange hair crouching on skates against light blue. Her white hockey stick bisects the image diagonally. Nearly all else adheres to right angles, except for the curves of breasts, elbow, and rump. Leisure, which shows a woman in summer white riding a bicycle and accompanied by her dog, is divided by a series of horizontal lines and forms. And in Rebellion, a running woman brandishes a banner of hot pink, the color of the day, whose curling corners echo those of her raincoat."
So Jennifer Coates, it's interesting that we've had pointillism come up in the accompanying text of a couple of times already this evening. Holland Cotter referring to the pointillism of the night sky, and Jennifer Coates, the biological something pointillism of the God knows what. Anyway, these are strange and fun, are they not? Do you find them satisfying? Do they make you hungry, Alexi?
Hungry, certainly not. But I'm a compromised speaker on these paintings because I'm friends with Jennifer. But I also, I think I can say candidly and honestly that I was delighted by this show. I was delighted by the way it felt like a kind of manic all-nighter's worth of work. It felt comic. It felt impulsive. It felt colloquial. It felt smart, but kind of reckless and uneven. I liked some of the paintings much. I liked, for instance, the lion cookie enormously, and the kind of weirdly anatomical-looking sandwich paintings that were near it, whereas the s'mores, for instance, felt just glib, just a kind of throwaway. But the overall spirit of the show, I enjoyed it a lot. I felt it just, as I say, it had a kind of, it seemed like a painterly comedian with a project in mind, delivering it. And unlike some kinds of comedians, it felt like one-liners were being, or kind of relatively resonant one-liners were being dropped. Some didn't work, some did. Totally overhung, a kind of deliberate amateurishness to the hang in the gallery, and even to the catalog, where she produced multiple pages of free associative, tart, funny, evocative thoughts about her work. It felt, to me, it was all one impression of a kind of freewheeling, weirdly, it's something about it feels heartfelt to me.
Yes.
In its kind of, and it had a kind of sloppiness while being enormously focused on these simple icons of processed food.
Yeah, but they actually, it's funny how, you know, moving from Chelsea and a septuagenarian iconic painter, artist to Lower East Side, younger artist, different sensibility in many ways. The number of overlaps actually between Celmins and Coates
really?
in the obsessiveness.
I don't see that at all.
Oh, me neither.
In finding a counterintuitive poetry in things of banality, primarily.
But now I feel like you're comparing, even if it's poetry, it's like Emily Dickinson meets Allen Ginsberg. It's,
right.
You know, this is beat poetry if it's poetry. This is all yop.
I'm trying to think of a fast food version of Apples and Oranges.
Yeah.
The fast food version is, by the way, the Fat Boys song, which I think this title references the 1985 song, which probably some of you remember. By the early rap group, the Fat Boys, who did a song called "All You Can Eat," with which was a litany of there's actually a music video where they go to the Times Square Sparrow, and it has a $3.99 special, and they eat everything, and then they run out without paying, but the verses are just listing all the food they're eating, and the show was kind of the same thing, a lot of the same food.
See, to me, if there was something I appreciated about the show, it was a kind of warmth towards,
yeah.
And one thing I wrote down when I was looking at the show, when I started looking at the paintings much more closely and getting up, really getting up close to them, there's one particular passage, and it's in the TV dinner, the potatoes, and there, and then I was reading about her process, and sometimes she applies these gel, I'm not a painter, so I'm going to botch this, but something to make the surface shiny. And I just thought that perfectly captures what those potatoes are like. That is those potatoes. And then you're absolutely right about she has some, I mean, it's worth looking at here, because I wrote down a couple of things she said about her And, you know, I'm not especially fond of the idea of, you know, you read something and suddenly you come to a better appreciation of it. I'm much more of the Donald Judd, like, you get it or you don't. But, you know, she says, as I husband the plainer receptacle of muck that is the canvas, I want the paint to stand in for as many things as possible. And I read that and I thought, that's exactly what she's doing. She kind of set out to do that and she did it. And there's something really satisfying about that. But I also just want to add, I do also like her, the way in which she's kind of, I don't want to say using the food as an excuse for, because that's not quite it, but she's painting this food, but she's also doing like a Jackson Pollock or it's, you know, she's kind of going through the history of painting in this, you know, matching it with this, you know, processed food. And there is a really pointed humor to that.
I think there's a definite, I mean, it's almost channeling Wayne Thiebaud in the painterliness and the edibility. But
I think it's not like Thiebaud in that.
Well, it's not like Thiebaud because
so
Thiebaud loves
controlled
food.
And so.
But Thiebaud loves paint. And I think she kind of has a love-hate with paint just as she does with processed food. I think that that she's sort of parodying abstract expressionism in what's essentially a kind of pop iconography.
Like with the mustard on the pretzels and the...
Well, all over, all the... You know, it's almost saying that paint is not nourishing now, that the paint has been compromised just as food has been compromised. And there is, I mean, she's definitely, you know, it's not just from the statements, but sure, there's a lot of humor, but there's also, there's an anger pulsating through these paintings about what's happened to food, isn't there?
There's a kind of aggression.
Yeah. Would you go with that?
I mean, I think that, you know, we might speak a little bit of the same kind of hedging that Alexi spoke first about the first show that we saw, to the extent that the kind of, you know, the cartoony chunkiness that she clearly wants to transmit, which is, I think, fun and very much her niche, is somewhat... oftentimes in this work in particular, I'm thinking of the s'mores, where it's clear that she kind of wants to, forgive me, have her s'mores and eat it too. You know, her kind
Had
of, you know, her, yeah, all the food puns that come up are inevitable, yeah. Right? That this tension between the kind of the painterly and the gestural and the obviously deeply illustrative, kind of iconicity of these things, on which I think the productness of them is based, our intention. I will say that I thought that the you know, not to make too much of press releases, but I thought that the press release was, to some extent, I think you're absolutely right that the levity and the humor are gainsaid by what is clearly a very sort of self-righteous, even sanctimonious discourse about food and processed food. And, you know, in the press release itself, well, you know, your Snickers bar could have been made by some enslaved child. And, you know, that's all well and good, and it's a noble cause to take up, but it has nothing to do with the work on the walls. And I think that it's...
I'm pretty sure she wrote it. They're not a gallery.
I don't care who wrote it. If she wrote it or the gallery wrote it, it's still disingenuous to the extent that it seems... deeply sort of portentous, a complete disjuncture between the work that she's producing.
That's kind of like putting a headline on a story that has nothing to do with the story so someone will click on it. It's like, you know, big food is a hot topic, you know. I agree with you, like, that to me, I didn't see that in the paintings at all, and I was sorry that I had read it before I went there.
Yeah, yeah. Because I never read the press release before I see the show, ever.
Unfortunately, because, I did.
Yeah.
But yeah, I thought that was...
It's like watching the trailer of the movie. They give, you know, and it's prepackaged. They package it in the way that, you know, they want you to consume it. And I thought that the kind of, you know, there's a lot of Thiebaud. She's clearly, you know, pop is obviously, you know, everything from Wesselman to Rosenquist.
But it's also that pop thing of pop very self-consciously following. Panelists, let's look at our audience. Let's of pop very self-consciously following abex and reacting to and against abex. And so it's a pop subject, but in a way, I think the hidden, the real subject is kind of abstract expressionist painting that she's parodying and utilizing simultaneously.
I don't think she's parodying it. I think she's kind of having fun with it.
Well, the parody can be fun, can't it?
This is back to the conversation earlier about kind of historicity or retrospectiveness or something. Mm. I feel like, of course, all that's true, that one sees immediately pop and, you know, iconic food packaging references. That's there, and it's mentioned in the press release or in her essays. But it feels surprisingly kind of loose or separated from that. It doesn't feel like it's artfully referencing the things it could be referencing. It feels like it's trying to stay kind of to kind of forget all that and to work from a kind of anarchic colloquial point of view.
But pop itself was always deeply ambivalent and fraught, right? I mean, the second that it was introduced in both sort of Warhol and Liechtenstein and you know, in Rosenquist, for example, those some of his paintings when they were exhibited abroad were taken as, so for example, when his F-bomber was exhibited in Rome, it caused a scandal because it was taken as this sort of celebration of American culture and military might, when it was, of course, this kind of critical dismantling of it, right? But pop very quickly, the critical edge of pop was very just as quickly dulled by its simultaneous participation in those icons. And I think that she walks a similar kind of, I mean, there is a real playfulness and a seduction. I mean, that sugar cookie, the pink sugar cookie, the crack allure of the painting and the way, I mean, it actually did make me want to eat a cookie. And so there is a little bit of that love-hate.
But there's a game going on in her painting of bad cooking, I think. And Rosenquist is a very good call, a very good point of comparison, because you think of that painting of his that's got the Heinz spaghetti and this great field of it, and then juxtaposed a sort of David Sally a generation, obviously two generations ahead
of David
Sally.
They're dialectical,
but it's impossible not to look at his spaghetti and think of Pollock, and it's a sort of joke about Pollock, I think, as well as a statement about processed food and mass production and plenty and excess and imagery and advertising. So it's all there in it. And I think she's doing that, but it's also got that Gustonian oafishness about it.
Mm. Oafishness, yes, that sounds right. And that's kind of, to me, in line with what I was saying before, that I felt like she's trying to separate herself from too much art historical knowledge, which would be easy to, you know, it's essentially too many cooks in the kitchen, and instead to be working like you're thinking about rap music or the Ramones or something like that. Just blind yourself a little bit, and that's the attitude. And it's an attitude I feel like is enjoyable even when an individual painting isn't.
I think her environmental concerns are very genuine and very deep. I mean, I also know her, and so that's anecdotal. I don't necessarily get it from the paintings per se, more from the statement. Does any of that come across for you, Sarah?
I was actually thinking something different, that she, not in the press release, but she points out it somewhere, maybe in an interview. You know, there's one of a Snickers bar, a Mars bar, I can't remember which one, and she sort of says that, so it's a cross section, and she talks about appreciating the form of that cross section. I think she compares it to a tomb, an architectural form. And that does come across in the painting, that kind of, and that's a kooky thing, but it's all, it, you know.
No pun intended.
No pun intended.
It also, I mean, the size and the scale also, I mean, I mean, they're not quite Oldenburg, of course, but there is that same sort of hypertrophic sort of reification of these things to underscore their artificiality too. I mean, maybe that's part of the love-hate that David mentioned.
Yeah, because they're also kind of realist paintings of synthetic food, as well as being synthetic paintings of real. You know, that's the play between the synthetic and the real is not just in vision, but also in touch. Yeah, well, let's go to something that's very clean at the edges and but nonetheless highly synthetic. The work of the German, Leonhard Hurzlmeiser. I just walked into these and fell in love with them. I just thought the chutzpah of them, but the pizzazz, and just seductively silly at first, and then when you silly and yet incredibly sophisticated, anybody care to jump in on against that or with that?
No, I felt very similarly to that. That I, of all the shows we've talked about, despite my professed love for Vija Celmins, this is the one I really enjoyed the most, and I think it does hit you right when you come in, and that they're at once whimsical and highly sophisticated, and they're the kind of paintings to me where you look at them and you do start going through all these, you know, you see Picasso in there, especially with the figure that's kind of crouched.
Yes.
Looks like it's on the beach. And I was thinking a lot about purism when I was looking at the show.
Definitely, purism.
Which you don't see that coming into painting a lot, and that was refreshing.
Like Leger, but also Amadei Ozenfant was with its creaminess, yes.
And I think there's, you know, again, there's this sense of humor that the old woman with the pearls, this was actually pointed out in one of the reviews. It's like, did she steal these? You know, there's a, and I just think then just to appreciate how he is putting these shapes together that, you know, could almost slide into abstraction in certain passages, an arrangement of shapes, such as in Leger, where he's almost abstract. And also then you go upstairs, and this is a little bit about the setting too, but those works on paper are just luminous and strange. And I almost like
very
those
different
even
aesthetic,
better.
Aren't they?
Yeah. And just the, and I mean, but when you talk about the space, just the particular space of that gallery, the way it's skylit, it just, they really are in their best environment there. So I think that added to my impression of them. I'd love to hear from someone who hated these.
I didn't hate them per se. I think that they are not really, I don't think of them even as paintings. I think that they're charming illustrations, really. I think that they almost could be spared being put on canvas. And they're interesting. They certainly conjure up everything from Stuart Davis to, of course, the purists and an American painter named Hilaire Hillet. He had this French name who sort of was this hybrid of purism and American kind of regionalism.
Or even Richard Lindner in a way.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. And the you know, those sort of the edges mix with the chunkiness mix with transparency. There is something seductive about it. But, you know, I mean, I think that they seem too sort of illustrative to me. I mean, they clearly partake of something of that, you know, 1920s, 30s, yeah. Neue Sachlichkeit, you know, corpulence, but the pressing flat, the mix of those two things makes them seem almost like kind of emoticons to me rather than paintings. And,
oh, really? Yeah, I'm interested in that because they definitely, of course, they are playing on their own graphic quality and historic allusions to, I mean, the British painter William Roberts also definitely comes to my mind. To me, actually, they do need to be paintings because of the second motif, which is the kind of the color field minimal painting quality that comes across, that we actually, this is again, this having your cake and eating it thing, this wafer being the wafer and the body of Christ at the same time, that if they were just graphics. They would be charming and fine and okay, but the fact of there being paintings, very, very beautifully dispatched paintings, but we do get that shape, that color, that form in a strong dose. Would you agree, Alexi?
I do. I'm interested by Ada's resistance, especially here, because I feel some of it myself, and there's a worry as a painter that we're all so readily beguiled by the sheer fact of something being delivered in oil paint on canvas, that a kind of successful graphic design with that surface is so much speaks to our, you know, our appetites, and these sometimes speak too easily to them. I find them enormously beguiling. I share, I think the three of us maybe
they're
share.
Fun.
I admire, I feel like Odd is being more scrupulous, and I wish I wasn't so easily seduced and beguiled. They, you know, to me, the things that pull, I guess I was interested in the gallery and why they seem to be succeeding and not falling into the things they so nearly are. The two things I thought of were obviously comics. Somebody like Chris Ware, I think, is in his head. And also not just 30s illustration, which is certainly their advertising, but also children's, there's like children's toys, wooden, the painting of the faces particularly seems to me a deliberate reference to...
Oh, what's his name, did those toys?
DePero. No?
Feininger. Lionel Feininger sort of.
I wasn't thinking of Feininger, but that makes sense. And there's others. Anyway, those things seem to me to just pull it away from what could be over familiar enough so that we kind of gave in to their cheer and their kind of jaunty delicacy.
But they're not all cheer.
I mean, there's a darkness too that. I mean, one of them appears to be like, what was it, vomiting or something, holding a chicken and...
She's...
Upstairs, they got a little darker, didn't they? Yes.
The woman is spitting out like ground up chicken into the bowl of the hands below. That's an odd one. That's the most...
Yeah. And then the old woman with the pearls, and I think, you know, when you say, oh, they could be emojis, I mean, I completely disagree with that because their meaning isn't stable enough for that. You know, like, but
I don't think they're really pursuing meaning though, right? I mean, jauntiness and a kind of and trying to strike a certain meaning.
I
mean, their meaning is in
jaunty.
Their meaning, I think, is in the sort of the comic-like flattened illustrative nature, which is one of, I mean, you know, again, the press release says these are this variety of erotically charged images of women, and they're about as erotically charged as my iPhone, right? But I think it's important to underscore being presented, right?
I thought that was artful about them. I thought like the beach one. I don't know if it's going to come up, the one that's almost like a letter D.
That's the one that struck me as
Picasso. That's the most graphic. That's the most.
Yes, it's the most graphic. They're all
the most
Picasso. That might be the most. You're right. But it also, I felt like you need to do so little to get the kind of erotic charge that you're referring with just a few shapes to a kind of.
That's why Richard Lindner and also Alan Jones come to my mind because of this. And I'm surprised that no one, perhaps our audience will be doing so, but I'm surprised. I was delighted to see Roberta Smith give her a good review, and Sarah loves the work. I'm surprised that there's no sort of feminist critique of
Roberta
the
Smith loves everything. So I mean, she's not going
she
to.
Doesn't. Yes. Come on. Yes.
That's but I it's funny. I mean, I
news to me.
Again, like, you know, I don't want to go to things that are outside of what we could get just by seeing the work.
Yeah.
However, you know, if you, he has a brother who identifies as a woman who I believe is autistic. And so when he says all new women, he's talking about his brother.
Oh, right. Okay.
It's more complex because I kind of was found that a little grating too. It's kind of
you
like,
needed to know that you found it by accident, or you wanted to. I mean, sorry. Of course, you discovered it, but you needed to dig deeper to find that.
I mean, in the sense that I asked Rach Loeffner. Yes.
Yes. Right.
But that, to me, that's interesting, but not just because it kind of is an anecdote that could slightly, you know, help us to empathize with the mind of the painter, but because it seems like there's two futures here. And one is that 5 years from now, we'll be thinking, like, why was I beguiled by those little charmsters, which were only ever destined to be slight?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or we could be thinking that what got this artist to pull away from a range of obvious modernist sources and individuate himself that far could continue, and that something of kind of a distinctive experience and take on sexuality is a motor that's just beginning to do more interesting things.
Right, because I do think they are quite deliberately transgressive. I think there's a certain bad boy in doing both illustration and the focus on the female, but I think also it's significant to me that he's looking back, that the element of pastiche in the work is actually looking back to a historic moment where popular illustration and high modernist experimentation intercepted, and where there's a certain, therefore, a kitsch element in Elzitsky or Leger, and a very modern, streamlined, interesting, exciting element to the graphic design of the 20s and 30s. In fact, Roberta cited the most famous guy, whose name I've forgotten now, Ukrainian-born guy who designed the Yves Saint Laurent logo and other things, steamships and things. So, but it's that moment where modernist language becomes a vernacular. It's the high low. It's
Art Deco. That's Art Deco. Yeah, Art Deco was the domestication. Art Deco,
exactly.
It's
not high artists looking at popular illustration. It's popular illustration sucking something from high art. And I think that for him, at this historic, I think that's where, Dennis, that's where we're getting a possibility of, that's why I think in a few years he won't necessarily just be this curiosity of the 20 teens, because there's a hunger for something there.
And I think that becomes also apparent when you go upstairs and see the drawings.
You see that I have a problem with the drawings. The drawings are nice, but they're not important enough. They just feel, because there are hundreds of people doing nice schematic, handmade drawings and paintings. I think he needs the scale. This is where I would answer Ara, that he needs the scale and the finesse for the painting, for the project to actually have any significance.
Well, it's interesting that he's measuring the dimensions of the canvas according to the body. I mean, the canvas is measured precisely to the dimensions of each individual body, which is interesting, right? There is no depth of field. There is no, the body determines the scale of the canvas, which is interesting, but still relatively, for me, does not manage to sort of lift them into terribly far outside of illustration for me.
Right. Cool. Well, I think our audience needs to come in at this point, because there's stuff to talk about with both of these. Again, let's start with the last. Let's start with Hurzlmeiser. Just out of curiosity, how many of our audience saw Coates or Hurzlmeiser? Oh, wow.
Oh.
Same ratio as your panel. Okay, great. So you must be bursting with things to say. So anybody wish to weigh in on Hurzlmeier's, do they need to be paintings, or are they just beguiling images? That's one of the themes that came up. Is there a dark and personal subtext, or is it a whimsical play with postmodern language and the high-low dichotomy? The front row. Thank you.
I have to admit, I did not see this show, so I have a question for you. Was there anything about seeing this work in person that differentiates it from feeling very graphic and illustrative on screen.
Not really.
Did it give you more?
Yes, there are all kinds of palimpsest areas, but they're very delicate. They're not like, this is back to the question about kind of hedging bets. They're not trying to show off the multiple decisions underneath them, but they're there. And I think you feel them, you sense them. In some places you see them, but it's quite, I admire that about them, that they're not relying on the, look how many prior, decisions I made to get this simple curve. But I do feel like in person they have a little extra weight of a kind of tacit history. So yes, I think that they're certainly made more graphic by a good deal in reproduction.
Yeah.
I didn't see the work, but I absolutely hate it. I can't imagine anything more degrading. This guy must really hate women. I mean, it's like, let's put women in the most comical, ridiculous situations that we can put them in, objectify them, flatten them out, make them completely inhuman, and call it jaunty and cute. Hated them, found them so sexist, I can't even.
I mean, it's funny, I'm just speaking as the only woman on this panel. I didn't get that from them. In fact, it's like, do you get that from Picasso? Because there's some of that there too, that kind of objectification. I think he's sort of playing with these. I mean, I was going to say there's something about these paintings where each one is, it's sort of like, now I'm riding my bike. Now I'm doing, there is this kind of weird, the taking on of a persona or something. I think they're meant to have that quality. I don't find it insulting. But I can see how it would read that way.
I'm pleased, Anna, by that comment, because I wanted them to be transgressive in order to like them even more. But I think that definitely he's playing with, he's definitely walking on thin ice. And so I was surprised by the lack of that sense in the critical response, both here and in the press. But maybe there's just secret boiling not far from the surface. A dismissal of them for that reason, but I think that it's part of their transgression, part of what they think they're playing with.
But above all, it's the, in a way, to have. I'm glad you had a strong viewpoint on it, and David, I'm glad you mentioned that, because it is. I feel like as a more sympathetic viewer, I still felt that anxiety a little bit. What would be the most hostile take on this work? I'm glad to have it articulated. And it seems to me that those two paintings, which are a pair on the end wall, the bicyclist and the protester, are maybe the key for thinking about that, because the protester could come across. It could come across as a patronizing kind of trivializing version
of an
explicitly female protest.
Kind of glib.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't.
But I think there's also a direct reference in that pairing to Leger, who's the communist painter who also paints girls on bicycles. So it's.
That's true.
That it's there's something in the graphics that it's relating to that's populist. So here's a high artist looking at a populist idiom. Here's presumably a intelligent, clued-in new man playing a game with a kind of post-feminism that sort of teeters on maybe anti-feminism.
But if you take into account his personal, his own story, his own situation, maybe he's trying to understand, okay, if my brother, who has these, problems, and
gender
and
then, dis.
No, no. I think he also is autistic or has or is mentally ill anyhow. But he does identify as a woman. Maybe this is a person trying to figure out, well, what, you know, what do we think of when we think about women? And maybe some of it is these stereotypes, but he's allowing himself to go there. I mean, you know, obviously we could get into a discussion about who should or shouldn't paint what. Mm. You know.
Come back in May for that panel. yes, gentleman there.
When you go into the gallery, the first painting you see on the right-hand side is a picture of a man eating an apple, which I think is a little wink, perhaps like a reversal of Adam and Eve, maybe.
Or Paris.
Yeah. So I thought that was interesting. It seemed to me that he was looking in wonder at all these women around him. And the only thing that didn't keep me from going crazy looking at the paintings, because they're so tight, is a little, if you look closely, there's a looseness to them. You can see some of the marks.
So please speak into the mic.
I'm sorry.
I'm missing something, what you're saying.
And then I think some of the shapes and forms he achieves are only possible in painting. And that's what keeps it from being too illustrative in my mind. And then I'll throw one more thing. I think that upstairs felt kind of like Jawlensky drawings, which is...
What drawings?
Alexei Jawlensky, is
that yeah.
Oh, Jawlensky, yeah, Jawlensky. Right, yes.
I saw a little bit of that too, and also clay. There was a little bit of clay in there.
I liked seeing them though, because it made it seem like he wasn't completely OCD and had a little, he was having some fun. So thank you.
Great, cool.